It's a lovely Saturday morning. Many thanks for joining us on the program Politics Today on independent television and radio. Of course, you know it's a simulcast, which means you can watch us on television and also follow the program live on radio and also on our website at www.itvradionigeria.com. You can also follow us on our Facebook page and sure you post a comment there. All our social media handles are up and running, so you can be part of the conversation this beautiful Saturday morning on the program Politics Today on independent television and radio. Our major talking point is on Edo 2020 governance impact and public perception. But just before we dig deep into our conversations today on the program, let's quickly keep tabs with some of the happenings in the political scene as our major starting point on the program this lovely Saturday morning. My name is Sonny Duke Okoso. The PDP National Chairman, Uche Secondus, Sokoto State Governor, Aminu Tambuwa, Senator representing Abia Inaya Baribe, and some national officers of the PDP arrived in Benin City for the flag-off of the PDP gubernatorial campaign in Edo State. And we'll be bringing you that event live somewhere around 12 midday. So you look forward to that event. Also, the ruling All Progressives Congress, APC, says President Muhammadu Buhari's administration is delivering on key electoral promises of securing the nation, fighting corruption, and improving the economy and livelihoods. APC Deputy National Publicity Secretary, Mr. Yekini Nabena, said this in statement in Abuja yesterday. Nabena was reacting to a statement by the national chairman of the People's Democratic Party calling on President Buhari to resign over the challenges that are bedeviling the country as a result of the unending security problem that has bedeviled the country. Some of the stories that we're keeping tabs with, and I hope to update you in the course of the program. But today on the show, as I said, we're looking at Edo 2020 impact of governance and public perception. And I'm joined now in the studio by Director of Research with the ADP. I'd like to thank very specially Comrade Christopher Ojekere for joining us on the program.
Thank you, Sonny. Good morning.
We also have with us in the studio Comrade Edafe Joshua. He's the Publicity Secretary, State Publicity Secretary of Zenith Labour Party. Many thanks for joining us on the program.
Thank you so much. Good morning.
Okay. In the course of the program, a civil activist, Comrade Tony Era, will be joining us live via Skype to engage the issue that we have on the ground for today. Okay, I want us to key off the discussion, Comrade Christopher Ojekere. Today, the PDP is officially kick-starting their campaign for the 2020 governorship election. And you know, like in a football match, which is a competition, just like we have for the election, it's always the defending champion that is the team to beat. I don't know what your thoughts are taking off from that point.
Because the defending champion has the trophy
already.
And to have obtained the trophy from the beginning, it means it must have done some work and achieved some results. And that result has set a bar and a standard. So if you are coming to rest that trophy, you have to put in some work. So the defending champion is the one that is to beat. The PDP in the state transmogrified, as those who love tongue twisting words will put it. Within a short space of time, it became clear to the APC that they have just lost one of their best performing governors. And as a result of some conjunction of events, which were very unfortunate, if truth is to be spoken, Governor Godwin Obaseki of the APC, a shining light in that party, moved over into the PDP. And before you could say Jack Robinson, the state Edo had become a PDP state. Perhaps it did not occur to APC when they were pushing out the governor that if the governor moved to PDP, the state would transmute automatically into a PDP state. So we now have a situation where 3 years on Godwin Obaseki's administration, it was an APC state. And at the twilight of that administration, running into an election, we now say it is the APC that is in the opposition trying to wrest power from the PDP. Well, be that as it may have turned out well for Edo people. Because, as you know, I'm an apostle of regionalism and regional integration. So I'm happy that for the first time, we have APC that had always been there as what you may refer to as a lone child within the family, you know, becoming integrated with the South-South PDP family. The entire South-South is PDP, and that is why even when APC seemed to have won Bayelsa, the people of Bayelsa reclaimed their mind. Because we know ourselves, we understand the language that we speak, and so we know where we want to go. So Edo State, as of today, is a PDP state, and the APC has to work hard to take this state back from PDP. But the truth of the matter is that that is mission impossible. Because the man that they have let go, who was a shining light in the APC, when he was there, he was the envy of PDP. PDP had hoped and wished that they would have a governor like this who will move into the PDP and then stabilize their party so that they can shore up, you know, their depleting image within the country so that they will be able to begin to think of some positive results in 2023. But the careless APC allowed such man to go. Now, Godwin Obaseki moving into the PDP has brought in a huge profile for the PDP. You will not be surprised to find that the national chairman of the PDP himself and the Sokoto State governor already in Edo State for the flag off. That tells you the importance that PDP places on this election. And of course, they are not the only ones that are going to come. Yeah. Those are the ones that have just arrived. Yeah. Others are going to come. Yeah. The entire PDP machinery is going to move into Edo State today because they want to make a statement that they appreciate that gift that Oshiomhole has given to them, you know, by moving Godwin Obaseki into the PDP. So the PDP and Godwin Obaseki are the champions to beat in this election.
Okay.
And that's where we are.
Let me push it. Let me get the perspectives of Comrade Edafe Joshua on where we started off from, impact of governance and Edo 2020 public perception. Do you also subscribe to this line of reasoning that the PDP now is a team to beat, even though, like you said, 3 years down the line, Edo State supposedly was an APC state? Yeah.
Thank you so much. I read something that was very, very insulting this morning. Mm. Something that says, a document that says APC and PDP are the two major contenders for the governorship election. That is an insult. Mm. Where there is 14 approved registered parties.
Okay.
And 14 governorship candidates with their deputies aspiring for one position, you don't limit it to just two contenders. Every of the candidates are on the same pedestal. They have the equal rights. They have, in fact, they are equal contenders. Mm. It may shock you that these two parties will not emerge because there are so many war going on the ground. I have always said, and I will maintain, APC and PDP are the problem of Nigeria. The moment the citizens look beyond APC and PDP, we'll move forward. Because it is the same people that have been in APC that moved to PDP, the same people that have been in PDP that are moving back to APC. Just yesterday, Yakubu Dogara, the former Speaker of the House of Representatives, left from PDP back to APC.
Yeah.
What has changed? You now see that it's just like a man coming in, changing his clothes, still coming back, remaining the same man. Now, when they say Edo State is improving, the governor is performing, this government is performing, I keep asking if it is not the same Edo State that we all live in. Now, the question is, you measure impact by the result that is reflected in the lives of the citizens. Now, what has happened to poverty? Poverty level is still very, very high. What has happened to unemployment? What has happened to illegal migration, human trafficking? What has happened to crimes? What has happened to armed robbery? What has happened to, you know, what is changing? Edo State has one of the worst road network. Entry and exit Edo State, very deplorable. You will say it is federal road. Is it a federal state? Now, the truth is, the government have not been sincere. A government should not be celebrated for paying worker salary, because if they, a government that doesn't pay worker salary should be stoned.
So you're saying, in effect, that the notion or the perception in some quarters that the PDP, for example, is the party to beat is a wrong notion.
It's a wrong notion.
Okay, let me just bring on board the program. Comrade Tony Era is joining us via Skype from Abuja. Comrade, good morning, and thank you for joining us on Politics Today.
Good morning to you, Sonny Kokosun, and to my viewers all over there and those who are present with you.
Thank you, Comrade Tony. Yeah, so we started off our conversation by looking at governance and Edo 2020 and the public perception. What are your thoughts? Looking at the insinuations that, of course, that the PDP, which is now the ruling party in Edo State, is the team to beat as the defending champion, as Comrade Christopher Ojekere puts it a while ago. What are your thoughts?
Well, this statement, I think that statement is not here and there. It's a statement that has no bearing with situations on the ground. Because up to now, we are aware of the so many years of PDP misrule in Edo State, where the people up to now are still not happy. And we are also aware that you know too, that it is that brought in the APC. But be as it is now, I don't think PDP is in a place to be able to win Edo. That is my own perception of it. Because the PDP, they have so many years of waste, has made the Edo people not to trust them. And that the present governor has gone from APC to PDP is not palatable, because I know that he has not measured up. And even if he has measured up, according to what people say, some people say, the crisis situation in Edo that was in APC that he has taken to PDP will still not help Edo. And I think PDP is not on the ground. And you will be so shocked that APC would defeat PDP in Edo State.
Okay.
Then I heard one of your guests here saying PDP and APC are not the only parties on the ground. Well, that is true. But I think PDP and APC are the only parties from which we have it or like it or not, where the governance can come from right now. But I think APC has the upper hand. And PDP is not on the ground to win this Edo election.
Okay. Comrade Tony, I'll pause you there, because obviously the thoughts and perspective that you have expressed are entirely yours. All right, let me come to Comrade Christopher Ojekere. Chris, what are your thoughts and your insights into impact of governance and the Edo 2020? And what is the feelings, perceptions on the part of the public? Your perspective now should come from your being the director of research, ADP, in Edo State. Yeah.
Now, first, let us recast our minds back to the definition of democracy by Abraham Lincoln, which has been accepted as the most popular and acceptable definition. Democracy is a government of the people, by the people and for the people. You will notice that the last phrase there is for the people, and it is not coincidental. The reason why it is the last phrase is because the people are the ones to pass the final judgment. And so if it is for them, they are able to assess whether what you gave to them is good enough. Now, I will just start by saying that there have been some verdicts. The governor of Edo State was named by the people as the wake and see governor. Not by the status quo, but by the people, as the wake and see governor. They were not induced to do that. They did that as a result of certain developmental strides, which was beginning to affect them positively, for which they were excited, and in that excitement, named the governor as the wake and see governor. And I'm going to be giving you a rundown of some of these excitements, using even myself as an example in the very place where I live. So now, but before I come back to that, I just want to address the issue that stereotypically, we could say we have 14
political parties
participating in this election.
Yeah.
But the word you used when you asked the question was major parties.
Okay.
And they are called major because that they are the only parties that can boast of structures across the 18 local government and 192 wards of the state and 260-something, you know, units of the state.
Okay.
They are the ones that have the visibility and they have the followership, which Tony Ara admitted to. So why we believe that there should be room for liberalization of democracy so that smaller parties can develop, but smaller parties must know that it is a space for context. My party, for instance, we believe that we have to context. We have to context for that space. But if it's good, as the publicity secretary of the party for Zenith Labour Party, which itself is an offshoot of the old Labour Party, you know? So, I mean, they are beginning to move. It's only less than 2 years, but it's moved from Labour Party to Zenith Labour Party. So, and that's how the mobility has been. Now, because the mobility is to create and give a room, a platform for people with good intention. We must not be deceived, that's why I said stereotypically, by these textbook ideological, you know, definitions of party this and party that. The reality of Nigeria is that good men should look for platform with which they should express and, you know, impose upon the status quo what they have for the people, which is what Obaseki has done. He did it in APC. And the status quo in APC resisted. So he made a tactical and strategic move into another platform, which is the PDP, to do the same thing. And that is why you see the surge of followership. The people who are not the party have understood the revolution. They've understood the trajectory. That what Obaseki is doing is trying to liberalize democracy. And he's trying to liberalize democracy by works, by projects. I can assure you that when Obaseki came into governorship, he decided, perhaps before he came in, but after he came in, it's when we started to notice, he decided that it was not going to be business as usual. What did he do first? He separated governance from politicking and said, look, if you are politicians, go and play politics. Government house is not a bank. Government house is for governance of the state, irrespective of parties and people. And then he started to lay out policies before us. He said he has come for Edo State to find this economic prosperity. How are you going to do that? He said the first thing you will do is for youths like this to get not just employed, but skillfully trained. So he set up the Edo State Skill Development Center, which is usually, which is popularly called Edo Jobs. Now, I have done research, and that's why I'm telling you all this. I'm speaking from the standpoint of research. Now, as I speak to you, Edo State Skill Development Center manages about 4 subsidiaries. They manage the Edo Innovation Hub. They manage the Edo Production Center, which is in Sapele Road. They manage the Creative Edo Creative Hub. And they manage the Edo Food and Agricultural, you know, cluster.
So, Chris, what is the public perception of all these?
The public perception is the name they have given the governor. wake and see government.
Okay, let me
now
pause.
If you go, yes.
Yeah, let me pause. Okay. I'll come back to you in a moment. Comrade Joshua, yes. In which aspect of the conversation, as it relates to impact of governance and the public perception, that you think that your party, the Zenith Labour Party, has an answer better than what is currently obtainable in the state?
Now, my party, the Zenith Labour Party, candidate being Bishop Kalame, was the candidate for the People's Democratic Congress in the 2016 election, and I made it took the third position. Youngest of the candidates right now.
Okay.
Then he was 35, now he's 39 years old. His birthday is actually on Monday. Now, if at 35, first attempt, he took the third position, there is nothing stopping him or stopping my party from taking the first position.
So maybe second attempt, you can take second position.
First position, that's what we are aiming for. Now, the fact is, he said something.
Okay.
That the government house is not a bank. Now, the same governor, or the same government that have said the government house is not a bank, is rumored to have spent so much to win over candidates from opposition parties, from the opposition party and opposition parties, so that they will give him support to emerge, I mean, to come as a consensus governor at the gubernatorial election. Now, all to keep the process of primary elections. And then it was reported recently that over 35 political parties registered and registered. It was only two registered that were part of that 35, and that was because it was a faction from those parties, and they were giving money. Now, I used to say, and I always say, both APC and PD are moneyed followers. That is, their followers are influenced because there is money to share. My ideology. My good friend now, who is talking here, the day he stopped any from the government, there is plan. Imagine the commissioner for environment just resigned from the government, and then stories have been said about her having issues here, and the more we resign. Because the truth is, the followership of this government is based on motivation, what they are getting, no ideology. Now, if you say the governor has performed, or the government has performed, I keep asking, what has happened to poverty in the state? What happened to unemployment? Edo Innovation is talking about how many youths are in streets today replicating the skills they've been trained. These are settlement channels for their cronies. They used to encourage themselves, those who are loyal to the governor now, you know, supporting the governor, the case may be. Now, they made this, the settlements and the gratuities outflowing, these people are following them. Because there is no ideology, no conviction. The motivation is who they want to get. Most of the crowd you see following APC and PDP are paid to follow them.
Okay.
They are not following them because they want to see a difference in government.
So what is the public perception of this line?
Sincerely speaking,
yes.
The public perception about this government is very, very negative.
How can you substantiate that?
The truth is, we move the masses.
Okay.
Now, power belongs to the masses. Now, this election is between APC, PDP and the masses. Then they represent the masses.
Okay, let me pause it there. Yeah. Bring Tony Era in here, who is live from Abuja. Tony, once again, thank you for joining us on the program Politics Today. Now, the key issue here is public perception of the major contenders for Edo 2020. Do you think that the public, the people, the electorate, have been well educated, informed to know what to do, who best suits the state, to emerge from the 2020 governorship election?
Actually, I think the way the whole campaign is going on in Edo is slighted in such a way that the public do not benefit as a state by getting more awareness. But I think that instead of a politics that will be issue driven, all we have are situations where most of the contenders are foreign sort, evasives, and all that. It should be issue-driven.
Sure.
Like my gentleman, Mr. Jigri, said that the governor is a wait-and-see governor. What kind of a name is that? You have a wait-and-see democracy. Democracy is about people's participation. It's about people coming together to make decisions. Do people not wake up one morning and see projects on the street? And when those projects brought before the people, for the people to talk about what they want, it is one thing for government to put it. It is another for to see whether those projects have bearing with the people. And I am not so comfortable with some people who say that Governor Obaseki has performed. No. We don't want an individual, a government that depends only on individual. It should try to separate from people. When Governor Obaseki was campaigning then, he had no manifesto. And we can now see that because he had no manifesto, that is why it's called wait and see. where is the people participation in all his policies of his government?
Okay, so Comrade Tony, just a moment, Tony. Yeah, yes. If you say he didn't have a manifesto, he left somewhere now to another, point. So would that translate to me that the party where he left never had a manifesto? That's only one. Secondly, if he's now being he's been given a pseudonym, as we can see, and that came from the people, isn't that an expression of popularity and acceptance from the public?
Well, those who gave him that name and the people who accepted are never happy. Because I'm not sure that people are happy, that problems that are being done don't have their impact. That is called wake and see governor, injustice all in. We'll show you how despotic the governor could be. I'm also telling you that there's nothing that is better than the people saying this is what they want. If it's just like you having your own money, and when you have your money, somebody says he wants to sow a seed for you. You should go to tell that person that this money that is mine, this is the kind of plot earning. So they just wake up one day and say, this is what you want. And now we are hearing a situation where Pastor Isaiah has what is called simple agenda. He has come to tell the people, this is what I have to do when I'm elected. And we know the people spoke and say, well, this is our expectation. Okay. But even now, the governor is seeking for reaction. He doesn't have an agenda. Is that where the way government is run?
Okay, let me stop you, Tony. I'll come back to you in a moment. If you just join us, it's State Politics Today on Independent Television and Radio Benin. Remember, the program is on ITV and all our channels. GoTV channel 17 and Star Times channel 130 on UHF. You can reach us on channel 22. We're streaming live on our website, www.itvradionigeria.com. Of course, on Facebook at facebook.com/itvradionig. You can also follow us on our YouTube page, youtube.com/itvradionig. The focus of our discussion is on EDO 2020, governance impact and public perception. Let me come to Chris. Yes, you've been itching to something.
Yeah.
So let me just take
I'm having fun.
Okay.
Because we do respect to the young man and Tony.
Yes.
When you are talking, I thought syllogism. No disrespect to them. But they are running on what we call inverted syllogism.
Okay.
You say a thing, and you say I'll have to cancel. Now, he says, I will stop talking when I stop getting money from the government. Now, that to rumors that the 35 political parties and other oppositions are supporting the governor because he spent money. Now, and then he just says in the same breath that Obua, the Minister of Commission Environment, has resigned, and then he has left Obaseki's government. If Obaseki's government is sustained by largesse,
by sharing money.
Why would Omwa resign?
For example.
And why would he presume that I earn something from Abbasid? Which I don't. Are you following? So you cannot start out your life as a young man, living on rumor. You do research. I don't earn one cobra from Abbasid. I am discussing what is in the public domain. And that's why I included Tony Era, who says that we should jettison democracy, the people's verdict, and is looking for another manifesto. I mean, Tony Era is not a journalist. Reasoning like that, where is he going to lead young ones like this?
No.
The people have said that we are so satisfied because of the projects in lucky way that leads to my house when I move to that area. When you are walking on that road job rainy season, you prepare for what you will lose. You choose what you should lose. Whether it's your shoe or your handset or your handbag or your wife. End of that will be missing. Lucky way right now, I drove there when I was coming. It's like next one, the smoothest road. And the people there say, we woke up one morning and saw that lucky way has changed from being a pool to a road. And he said, the people's verdicts don't matter. No wonder he has spent too long writing papers. He's no longer dealing with realities. I am saying to you that Edo Jobs has about 160,000 youths, and I think this young man should apply. But I bet some of them have been given employment, some have given skills. Go to ICRC, one domain of information technology systems. These are measurable deliverables. They are verifiable concrete things. Go to Sape Road and see the industrial cluster, and you see the business support environment where businesses are allowed to interact with each other, develop skills, and then develop and create innovations and develop skills for young ones. So that beyond the basket, if you have developed the skill of how to website with your website, it remains with you. A basket will no longer be there, but it remains with you. Everybody wants to be in the civil service. We at the end of the month, we want to collect salary. That is not about employment. That is not development, that's not modern society. Modern society must begin to be structured. If you go to the agripreneur program, go to Warake, go to Afuze, no one is, go to Agbede, and go to, what do you call that place in Ishan? There's one place in Ishan.
Okay.
Go there and see go to Agbede and see the rice production going on as a result of the agricultural projects.
do your research, and then come back and say these things are not there. Actually, fertilizer company is functioning. It was developed to what called a PPP project. It's functioning. People go there and see it, and then there are roads. Go to Iriri and see the roads. Go to the roads linking from Airport Road to Sapele Road, and see the industrial land that's being laid there. People are going to build some business there. That's development. That's what we're talking about. We're not talking about, you know, textbook. He's in Abuja. Era is in Abuja. I'm talking about what is going on here. The simple idea that he refers to. It's not as simple as that. If we have to go by rumor mongering, according to my young man here, there's so much to laugh about it. And if I buy the college is finished, we know who the patent. Oh, now the simple agenda. And there is a video to it which I watched by myself, where Dr. Pedro Basaki was talking about the simple agenda as his own man, what do you call it, policy document, okay, and manifesto. Okay. And it is not true that the governor did not have a manifesto in 2016. I just gave the title of the manifesto, and that is prosperity for those states. He did not do enough, you know, what do you call it, investigative journalism to be able to find out money. It's part of the manifesto that the governor's island foundations for enduring projects. Okay. As I speak to you now, AMES, which is Atlantic Engineering Services, are still in talk about setting up a dry cargo party in the States, which will link up with the Gele Gele Seaport development that we're talking about. They're in talk. I'm aware of this. So what I'm trying to tell you is that there are projects, and I can begin to name them. If you go to the educational sector, 12,000 Edo teachers cannot deny. I attended the ceremonies. You know, where they were passing out, with that task, they were waving it in the air, just covered by ITV and other television stations. They have been trained on information. Some of them have never sat in front of a computer before that time. They have been trained on information technology.
Okay.
They have tabs to use for modern teaching.
Let me proceed, comrade Christopher Ojikere. Let me bring the Zen Labour Party State Publicity Secretary on board. Now, if in your opinion, like you've expressed consistently in the course of this program, the indices that Chris has eloquently spoken about will not be a factor in how the Edo 2020 governorship election will go, what are those key templates that will be the major determinants for the outcome of the election?
Now, the only reason why it seems as if people are in support of the governor, because between APC and PDP, in fact, it's out of pity.
Out of pity for
yes,
who?
For the governor.
Okay.
Reason is, oh, same as Molewu said, Izeyamu is a thief. And mind you, the same, Izeyamu did not collect money, is not alleged to have collected money for personal use. He was given money by PDP to campaign for PDP in the state. And even the chairman of PDP presently, he's also named in the suit,
yeah.
As it to the 700 million naira.
Campaign
so
cost.
If you want to even go into that case in detail, PDP is also a party.
Okay, we can't now, go into it. We can't go into yeah, it.
Now, another thing is, he mentioned I should go and apply. No, I don't need to apply because most of those projects are just on air. I will prove it to you. Now, the agricultural cluster program he's talking about, we have evidence to show that most of the projects they did in agriculture, poultry and whatever, were arranged. They brought farmers together, videotaped them, paid money into account and placed lien on the account. The farmers did not touch one cobble from the money, which is quite okay. They regulated who supplied, what was bought, how it was bought, when it was bought. At the time the farmers are supposed to be investing this product, I'm using just the poultry for instance, there was nobody to buy the products. They lost several thousands of beds, more than 50% of the beds that were supplied in survived. Till now, that program is not running. The program is not running. As for one, then it is not what the government is supposed to do. It should not be celebrated. Paying teachers salary, training teachers is something the government should do.
If these will not determine or be major determinants on how the election will go, from your perspective, what are those key determinants?
Yes. We have the take home agenda, transparent tax policy, and tax break. Edo State is partly civil and commercial driven.
Yeah.
So it is important to give new industries enough motivation through, you know, reasonable tax relief and tax breaks so that they can be able to create employment opportunities. Then we have what we call the agricultural revolution, not the kind of type of agricultural program we have right now. Then we have what we call keeping to promises. Both APC and PDP have never kept to any promise made to the people over the years. Then we have the education. Education is very, very important. In fact, compulsory education for all Edo citizens, both young and old. We have the youth, women, and senior citizen empowerment. Paying pensioners their pension is not something to be celebrated. It is their money.
Okay. So these are your key determinants of the election. Yes. Let me bring Comrade Tony Era again to join us. Tony, once again, thank you for holding on. We appreciate you.
Thank you.
All right, Tony, so let's get your thoughts. I mean, being a veteran journalist, environmentalist, political commentator, what are your perspective on the key determinants of the Edo 2020 governorship election? If you feel like you've expressed in the course of the discussion that what is currently being projected by the ruling party are not the key determinants here.
Thank you very much, Sonny Duke. But first of all, I will have to draw your attention to some statements that Chris Ojikere made. First of all, I want to tell Chris Ojikere that although I'm just visiting, I'm Muslim, you know. And I think by the things I do, I'm more open than Ojeke. Yes, I am not an anti-critic. I'm all around. I feel people, I feel just all around. If they favorite my people, they're wrong. It's a dissipating insanity. Talking about something that will not be. I can remember years back before the governor was coming, he said people made this illusion that an unripe man was coming to become a governor. So today we are now aware why that the woman did not make a mistake by saying an unripe man.
So in that sense, in that sense, I'd like to get your thoughts on what are then the key determinants of how the election will go.
Yeah. The key determinant on how the election will go are one, that first, the Edo State people know that this government that is on the ground is a lying government. A government that tries on propaganda. A government that tries on crisis. And I think that when you say
the government on the ground is a lying government, that's a bit of in the extreme, so to speak. And this is a personal opinion.
No,
let's just stay on call here.
Those are the issues. Hello, those are the issues that are on the ground that will determine the election. That they would not like to vote for a government that will say one thing and they mean another. And the government that will not tell people the truth. For instance, the agriculture project, as Jerry mentioned, you know, they are not on the ground. We are aware of what happened at Sobe. There are a lot of farm. I think from Ojekere's own local government. Governor Obaseki has taken away most of the lands in those states, not to local communities, to multinationals, companies, and all that. And I think if he fears his energy campaign for this government, what he would have done is to go to his original EP party, not PDP, not governor, and develop that party like the Zenith party is doing.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much, Congressman. Thank you so much. Still with us today on Independent Television and Radio. I mean, we hope you have a great time on the program so far. Our studio line will be open shortly, so you can also call and be part of the conversation. 052-290-573. That's the studio number. You can send a message to our Facebook page. You can send us a tweet at ITRadioNG. And follow me on my Snapchat Twitter handle at Duke Okosun. Send us a tweet as well. We'll respond to you. Okay, so it's policies today on Independent Television and Radio. Well, Christopher Ojekere, the election is here. What's your perception or perspectives on level of sensitization by the respective political parties, including your party, the ADP?
Now, but first of all, if I come to react, the reason I want to is because they didn't answer the question. If there are answers to a question, when the question is asked, the questions are answered. Your question was, what are going to be the determinant factors for voters to thumb their ballot papers on September 19th, as presented or as perceived of the parties that are involved? Perhaps the Senate party man here will tell us, because up until now, I wasn't even aware that the Senate party was part of the election.
Maybe you didn't do your research.
Yeah, I'm aware that Bishop Akame is in the election, but I didn't know that he was of the Zenith Party.
Okay. Yes. So you did your research.
Yes. So, but the PDP, according to which interest he seemed to be representing.
No, the APC.
Yeah, the APC, yes. Which interest he seemed to be representing. Yes. When you asked him, he turned the attention on me. That tells you that he had nothing to offer from his party that he's representing. But what would be the determinant factor? The determinant factor is this. Edo pensioners, a young man, does not seem to realize that if his father had died on the queue as an old man struggling to get his pension, that it would be a big deal for a new pensioner today to come and expectably get his pension. And that's why you think it's not something to be mentioned, it is not something to be counted as an achievement. But you should know that in this Edo state, pensioners fell and died on queues, waiting to collect their pensions, waiting to collect their gratuity. Today, the pension and gratuity scheme have been digitalized and regularized. That's why our aged fathers and mothers are given dignity of it. So from that generation down to the fourth generation, the old man is going to tell his fourth generation, vote Obaseki, who gave me that dignity. That's a determinant fact.
All right, let me guess. Civil service. Dr. Mane, you're live on the program. Just hold on for a second. We'll put you on. Yeah, I could point. Yeah.
Civil service. Are getting their salaries on the 24th of every month. They used to owe even up to 2-3 months salary.
Okay.
Now they can defray expenses and put the economy. It's a big deal to service. That is the big deal.
Edo State Health Insurance scheme in place to ramp up resources to be able to take care of the sick, the elderly, the weak, and the vulnerable. It's in place. It's going to be a determinant.
Okay, all right. Let me get
came back from Libya,
yeah,
and you said this thing failed. 43,000 strong. I met with their leader two weeks ago. 43,000 strong in Edo State, involved in catfish farming and poultry services, reinstated and rehabilitated by the governor. It is going to be a determinant factor.
Okay, let me pause you there now and get some of our callers on so they can be part of the conversation. Dr. Emmanuel Igudaro, former NMA chairman, Edo State, is live with us. Dr. Emmanuel, thank you for joining us on Politics Today. What are your thoughts? What are your opinions?
Thank you, Sonny Duke, and thank you, panelists. I think to very much extent, Chris Ojekere has made some wonderful points. The question asks, what are the determinants? I was amazed that nothing really came. But for me, the determinants are clear. We need to look at the welfare of the people. We need to look at the fact that in the previous time, we had salaries, 11 months, the local government, state, and so many other things that were not being done. Pensioners demonstrating on the street, but those are not things of the past. Those are not things of the past. You need to look at education. You need to look at job creation. A lot of people mistake the fact that job creation is not job employment in the civil service. It is an opportunity for you to learn a skill and further employ a lot of people. I think what we should be looking at are, what were the promises 4 years ago? What has happened to those promises? How far have they gone? Can we take them on the positive side?
Okay.
Those are the things we should look at.
Okay.
And I tell you, if you take those things, dot the I and cross the T, Obasanjo has a day performed so well.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Emmanuel Igudaro. We have our next caller on board. Hello, caller. Tell us your name and where you're calling
from. Good morning.
From.
My name is Friday.
Yes, Friday. Where are you calling from?
I'm calling from Benin.
Go ahead, Friday.
Okay. I just want to ask. They say the Obasanjo government is a lie government. A party that says in the last election, a man is a criminal. They are not telling us now that that man is a saint. How can we differentiate that? Go and look at testament rules. Go and look at the work that is going on there. Christ Ojekere represents we, the masses.
Thank
He's
you.
Telling us
Thank
the
you.
Facts. You understand?
Yeah.
Anybody that said Obaseki is not a good governor is going back. Because why? There is no Togri in the city, there is no CDA in the city. You know, we all are happy. Thank you so much.
All right, thank you, caller. We appreciate you. Our studio line is still open, 0522 290573. Hello, good morning. What's
good
your
morning.
Name?
Yes, Bishop Iso.
Okay, so, Bishop Iso. Yes, go ahead, Bishop Iso.
I greet all of you there.
Thank you.
Let me first of all address the young Zenith Labour Party mandate. That the immigrant says, if wishes were healthy, beggars will rise. So I think there's room for people to really have hope.
Okay.
I will say that one. I said it a long time ago on this Politics Today, that if APC makes the mistake of disallowing Obaseki from running for the second term, that will be the end of APC in Edo State. I said it when this matter started newly.
Yeah.
And that is exactly what has happened.
But
now.
We have to the wait till the election is over. Bishop, we have to wait till the election is over. The election has not been conducted. The election is not yet over. We're in the electioneering process. We have to wait to know if you are a prophet. We have to wait to know what kind of prophet you are. Bishop Iso.
Who forecast politics?
Yes.
Just as people forecast Cooper.
Yes.
I happen to have been one of those. That's why I mentioned it a long time ago.
All right.
And I advise, I said they should not make that mistake. You see the way people are now, you know, the capital from APC to PDP.
It's on both sides. Some are going to PDP, others are going to APC. It's on both sides.
Even, yes. That's it,
All right, thank you, Bishop Iso. Thank you, Bishop Iso. Sonic Edosa is joining us from Airport Road. Sonic Edosa, well, I can't tell exactly where you are now, but thank you for joining us on the program.
I'm actually close to Airport Road and
all right, so I was right. Go ahead, please.
Thank you very much. First of all, I want to say that politics is a game of interest, numbers, association, and the association. Tracking and retracking. That is what you have seen now in the few days.
Okay.
I'm sure that the former speaker has also done that, which is conditionally allowed to do.
Yeah.
I want to beg those who are insulting others, whether on social media, whether even at your in your studio there, that people have choice. I've often said that majority, we always have their way. They don't deprive the minority from having their say.
Yeah.
There's nothing like a major party. All the political parties met the requirements before INEC registered them. I think we should remember that. Then number two, if we do not want crisis in all the political parties, I am not a party carry member, but I have my interest in the party. But that should not mean if you don't allow party supremacy, that will cause continuous problems in the politics.
Okay.
One of the reasons that South Africa, ANC, is standing right now is because of party supremacy. They found out that when they went to the poll, even the young Julius Malema was coming to a place, they thought they were losing. They had to sacrifice Cameron Becky instead of losing 60 years.
Yeah.
They sacrificed the consumer. Right now, they are about to also sacrifice Cyril Ramaphosa because of the same issue.
Okay.
That can only happen when you have party supremacy.
All right, thank you.
So whether people join the PDP or not, at the end of the day, they are not going to decide.
Okay, thank you, Sonny Gedosa. I've got another caller. Oh, hello, caller. Good morning. What's your name?
My name is Okai Fosepe, also known as Oppo Secret, the radio professor.
Go ahead. We're listening to you. Go ahead. You're live on the program.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I think it is the truth, even if it is because it must be said. I think the die is already cast. Edo people cannot be fooled. You cannot play on our intelligence. Otherwise, it means that those states is no longer the heartbeat of Nigeria. You cannot tell us all the hullabaloos. Tell us, get somebody black and tell us that you know everything about that person. Then when you come to this and you come around again to come and tell us, no, I need to do this that at your age, close to 70 years. That is terrible. So we have learned our lessons. And whoever says that the basket is not working, the person is just lying. The person knows that the basket is working.
Okay.
The person just trying to make politics.
All right.
So the fact of the matter is that the margin of the vote is going to be very wide.
Okay.
You really come into a place where the vote margin is closed. Well, this one we are going to see is going to be unprecedented. So there's a video going up now that the candidate of the other party will go and make the talks, no talks, that they should go from fully good to good.
Okay. All right, Opusiki, I've got to pause you there so I can give another opportunity to another person. Comrade Austin Osakwe is joining us on the program. Hello, caller. Good morning.
Hello?
Yeah, hello. Good morning. What's your name?
Good morning.
Aminatu, just hold the line. We'll put you on in a moment, okay? Comrade Austin, you're live. Go ahead, please.
Good morning.
Yes, good morning, Comrade Austin Osakwe.
I greet you and the panelists there. I like the work you are doing.
Thank you, sir.
For me, it's very clear. You have asked what will shape the outcome of this election. And there are three things. The question must be asked, do we want to go back to the sordid past? A past in which market women were harassed with all kinds of levies beaten up in the public space? Do we want to go to the era where people spent so much money to buy land in this town and they were not able to build? Because it's been with that are taking over control of the community with the active support of those in authority in government. Do we want to go back to the past where old men and women, senior citizens, queued up in line, some of them dropped dead, with after working for the state for so long, now it was time for the state to reward them, to keep them alive until God will call them back. And we want to go back to the past. Look, one thing is clear, no matter what they say on air here, the people out there, why are they shouting 4+4 number? The people out there, why is there so much enthusiasm within their midst to go and vote for the incumbent? It's not because it's a sense. It is because of what they can see. We may not be able to enumerate all that he has done here on air, but the people out there who will go out and vote are aware. The big time politicians may think that it's business as usual. But this election is going to shape the future of democracy, not only in Edo State, but also in the whole of Nigeria.
All right, thank you.
And my household.
Thank you.
My vote is for Godwin Obaseki for performance in the past 4 years and the renewal of the mandate to continue to perform for another 4 years. God bless you.
All right, thank you, Comrade Austin Asakwe. We'll have Comrade Erasmus Ikhide just trying to link us up on the program. Hope he can get to us quickly before we call it a wrap on Politics Today on Independent Television this beautiful Saturday morning. Erasmus is joining us now. Erasmus, you have 30 seconds to quickly make your contribution. We're pressed for time. Yes, good morning. Thank you for joining us.
I listened briefly to what has been said by Comrade Osapwe and several others.
Yeah.
You see, when people like Comrade Osapwe...
No, I don't want to... Like don't take it on Comrade Osapwe. Just express yourself.
Hold on,
tell us what you think of our conversation, the topic, please. Focus on the issue. Leave us in Osapwe out or any other person. Yeah.
Where the issues are that...
Yeah.
The going back to Egypt that they have talked about,
yes,
we are more in Egypt now than we were before.
Okay.
What has taken place is that you have an exchange of an algorithm for another. The target that picked me a while ago said that in Benin, around Bobizwa Park, the set of algorithm that collected $1,000 for him for parking along the road. The demand said it's not parking.
Okay.
So we're talking about building of houses and all of that.
All right, thank you. Come here, Erasmus. My time is up.
That's what you call occasionally at the moment.
Yes.
Who are even worse than what you used to be.
Okay, so Erasmus. My time is up. I would have loved to continue with you, but my time is up. Tony Era, I want to say big thanks to you. Let's just see Tony one more time, joining us live from Abuja via Skype. Tony, thank you again for being a part of the program. We appreciate you.
Thank you
very much. Thank you, Comrade Christopher Jekere. Thank you so much for coming on the program.
Thank you.
And Comrade Idafe Joshua, thank you for coming on the program.
Thank you so much.
All right. I want to say big thanks to everybody who made the show a huge success, beginning with my general manager, Senior Ed Obedo Umose. Thank you so much. And it was very, very thorny yesterday putting this show together, but thank God how it went. Big thanks to our crew behind the scene. You can see them, for making the show a huge success. My name is Sonny Duke Okoso. Thanking you for staying with us. Remember, at 12 midday, we'll be joining the live broadcast of the PDP flag off of campaign for Edo 2020. Have a beautiful weekend, and bye for now.